Multisite Capacity Plus is a trunked radio system topology based on MOTOTRBO that supports up to 15 sites with up to 8 trunk repeaters at each site. In addition, up to 6 data revert channels are supported at each site. These dedicated channels would be used when there is a large amount of radio-to-server bound data required, such as regular GPS updates from thousands of radios. In a Multisite Capacity Plus system, one repeater is set up as the master. All other repeaters are set up as peers. Unlike Capacity Max, radios which are not in a call monitor the rest channel. When a call is set up, it is done on the rest channel, which then becomes a traffic channel to pass the call. The rest channel functionality is then moved to the next available slot, together with the radios not party to that call. The repeater, which is currently hosting the rest channel, will transmit a periodic beacon. This allows radios to measure the signal strength and to determine if there are any adjacent sites with a better signal. Since there is no trunking or site controller like in Capacity Max, talk group calls are streamed statically to the intended site, no matter if there is a radio on that site or not. In the master repeater, there is a table that lists the talk groups and which sites these should be streamed on. Individual calls are only streamed on the source and destination sites. Remember that the master repeater is not contiguous to network operation. That is, if the master repeater goes down, the network will continue to operate without issue. The site at which the master repeater is located will, however, operate at reduced capacity. The master repeater and the router to which it is connected need to have a static IP address. The router, in turn, should support and be configured for NAT. Lastly, Multisite Capacity Plus does not use or require a master controller, so there is no processing of things like presence or location information. That is, whether a radio is turned on and which site it's on. Now let's look at my setup. I have a two-site system with two repeaters and one router at each site. The two sites, the radio management server, and my laptop are all connected via a small switch which I have on my desk. My laptop is also connected to the internet through Wi-Fi, as I was streaming this video via GoToMeeting. The radio management server is also connected to a control station via USB. This would be used for OTAP. Since there is no DHCP server, the two routers, my PC, and the radio management server all have static IP addresses. I'm using SLR 5500s and MikroTik RB2011s. They're all mounted in a 19-inch flight case. I'm using dummy loads for antennas. In terms of IP addresses, the repeaters in all sites use the 192.168.1.0 subnet. Notice that I'm reusing the subnet on each site, since each site or repeaters are behind a router. The computers and routers all sit in the 172.31.0.0 subnet. For the setup, I'm going to refer back to my Multisite Capacity Plus cheat sheet, which you can find on my blog. The link is below. Let's get started. I have radio management open here, and as you can see, the database is empty. If you need more details on how radio management works, have a look at my videos on YouTube. To start, I'm going to add the first repeater. To do this, I need to get the serial number, and the easy way to do this is to use the device programmer. Just simply copy and paste the serial number as soon as it's detected on USB. I need to read the repeater and generate the configuration based on the red code plug. Once read, I can now edit the configuration. Before editing, I like to rename the configuration to something I can remember or something that is understandable. I'm only going to show you the important settings. The other settings are important and up to you, but they are not relevant here. Editing the configuration is much like setting up the repeater as if you had read it using CPS, so much of this should be familiar to you. It's up to you, but I like to disable all of the accessory pins unless they're used for something. Now, I'm narrating this afterwards, and if you pay attention, you'll have noticed that I made a mistake. you cannot have no res key in the repeater configuration. If I delete it, the field is shaded red. If you're not going to be using res, you just need to set authentication to disabled. If you forget like me, it'll get picked up when you run analyze. In network, you'll need to set the Ethernet IP address of the repeater. And you need to disable DHCP. You also need to set the gateway IP address as well as the net mask. All of this information is contained in the cheat sheet. Looking at my diagram, you will see that the repeaters are all in the 192.168.1.0 subnet. The router IP address is .1 and the repeater is .2. DNS is not being used, and I'll enable IP repeater programming later. In link establishment, I need to set this repeater as the master. When I do so, I'm asked for the IP address of the master repeater. This comes from the cheat sheet. In this field, I will put the IP address of the master repeater as it is seen from the WAN. So this will be 172.31.0.1. I'm also asked for the master UDP port here. I will use the default value of 50,000. The peer firewall open timer can be left at its default value. In Capacity Plus, I need to specify a site ID, site alias, as well as a REST channel site IP and port. The beacon duration and beacon interval can be left at their default values. The same applies to the REST channel timeout timer. The REST channel IP address and port number come from the cheat sheet. These should be the same on all repeaters and sites. MOTOTRBO link is not being used, and I'm not using anything related to phone patch. In the site tables, I need to add, in this case, two sites, since my system here consists of two logical sites. The neighbor of site 1 will be site 2, and the neighbor of site 2 will be site 1. Be very careful about the reserved wide area channels. Setting this to any value other than 0 will reserve that number of time slots on each repeater, and it could result in the system being busy for other calls that are not routed through to all sites. My suggestion here is to first set this value to 0 and then potentially at a later stage change this to something else should the need arise. Next, I need to define which talk groups need to be streamed to which sites. Here, you can create a table with the group ID and the site on which that talk group should be streamed. If you are not concerned about that, you don't need to complete this table and instead can tick all wide area talk groups. Now I can move on to the zone. By default, the repeater comes with two pre-programmed conventional channels. I don't need these, but I do need to add a Capacity Plus linked personality to the repeater. In the Link Capacity Plus Personality, you will need to set things like the color code, the repeater RSSI value, the preference level, as well as the slot ID. So, on a site, the first repeater will have slot ID 1 and 2, the second repeater will have slot ID 3 and 4, and so forth. You will also need to specify the operating frequencies as well as the transmit power and timeout timer. The frequencies will be those specified by your spectrum license issued by the telecommunications regulator in your country. Thank you. I will now add the second repeater. In a multi-site Capacity Plus system, each repeater needs to have its own configuration. So here, I need to read the repeater and generate a configuration, but I will not apply it to the radio yet. The repeater is now red, and what I'm going to do first is to change the radio ID of the repeaters. In a multi-site Capacity Plus system, or any MOTOTRBO system for that matter, all linked repeaters must have a unique radio ID. Another thing you may want to do is to give each repeater an understandable radio alias, showing maybe the site location and the name or some label related to where and what the hardware is. Now I can go in and edit the configuration. The first thing I like to do is to change the name of the configuration. By default, radio management uses the serial number. Here I'm going to put some understandable name of my own choosing. There is the usual configuration you see here, and one of the things you can do to save time is to copy sets between configurations. So here I'm going to simply copy the set from the repeater 1 configuration into this repeater. In network again, I need to specify the IP address of the repeater. You can use DHCP, but I like to use static IP addresses. Here, in this case, I'm going to use the IP address that comes from the cheat sheet, and this is 192.168.1.3. This repeater needs to be set up as a peer. Then I need to specify the IP address of the master repeater. The IP address is the IP address of the master repeater itself on the LAN, that is 192.168.1.2. To make sure the repeaters can communicate across the WAN, I'm going to set the UDP port of this repeater to be 50001. The master UDP port is 50000 and must match that what is in the master repeater. Next, I need to specify a site ID and site alias. The REST channel site IP and UDP port needs to be the same across all repeaters. Phone system and MOTOTRBO link is not used, and the sites I don't need to configure since this information comes from the master repeater. Now, I need to go into the zone and add a link capacity plus voice channel, then delete the two default channels already in the repeater. I go into the channel and set things like the channel name, the color code, the RSSI threshold, the preference level, as well as the slot 1 and slot 2 channel ID. Remember that since this is the second repeater on this site, you need to set the slot 1 channel ID to 3. Next, I need to specify a TX and RX frequency, as well as set the power level and the timeout timer. Now that I'm finished with the settings, I then need to go and assign the configuration to the repeaters and radio view. Right button click, select configuration and choose the configuration that matches the repeater. One thing I need to do, and this will help me when it comes to IP remote programming, is to add an IP system setting. To do this, go to Manage, IP System Settings, and then Add an IP system setting. Ask for the repeater type, as well as an alias and an IP address of the master repeater. This IP address needs to be the address of the master repeater, which is visible on the WAN. So in this case, it's 172.31.0.1. The UDP port is, of course, 50000. Once I have done that, I can assign the IP system settings to those repeaters. before I can program these repeaters, I need to make sure whether the repeater will be able to support Multisite Capacity Plus. As you can see here, the Multisite Capacity Plus feature has not yet been licensed. Add premium features, I need to go to Manage, and then to Licenses, and then Radio Licenses. In the window that appears, I need to enter the entitlement ID that was sent to me via email, then click on Query. Radio Management contacts the Motorola licensing server and determines what licenses are available on that entitlement ID, and at the same time, it will choose which devices can be activated with that license. So in this case, it brings up the two repeaters, and I can simply click on Add All, then click on the Register button. This will register the features and serial numbers, and all I need to do now is to activate it in the repeater. So when I go back to Radio View, I can see that in the modified column, the tan colored block is now shown. Hovering over this column will give you a clue to what the colors mean. Now I can go select the repeaters, right button click, and say Analyze. This will make Radio Management parse the configurations, and if there are any errors, these will be shown here. As you can see, I made a mistake with RAS. Without thinking, I deleted the RAS key from the configuration. The RAS key was there, but it was unknown. So to fix this, I need to create a new RAS key, add this to the repeater configuration, but set authentication to disabled. That means RAS is not used. If, however, you will use RAS, you need to set authentication to something else in security. As soon as I fix this, I can write the repeaters. One more analyze, and you can see that the repeaters come up green. This means no errors were found. Now let's write the configuration back to the repeaters. The device programmer connected to the repeaters is running on my radio management server. The radio management client is sitting on my PC. I'm programming via USB here, but I'll add IP remote programming later. One thing I like to do is to put the devices into groups. Here I'm creating two subgroups called Site 1 and Site 2. These two repeaters will go into the Site 1 subgroup. On very big systems with lots of radios and repeaters, this makes life a lot easier to find stuff. Now I'm going to add a radio. This is a DP4801E, and instead of trying to read and type in the serial number manually, I'm going to use my device programmer copy-paste trick. I add the serial number and schedule a read drop, remembering to tick Generate Configuration. Once read, I can go into the configuration and start editing it. If you have multiple radios of the same model and same setup, you can assign that same configuration to all of them. All of these settings are important and you need to go through all of these according to your own needs, but I'm only going to look at the things which make this radio work or not. Once read, the first thing I'm going to do is rename the configuration. There is the usual stuff in the general folder, but what I'm going to do first is to set up a list of contacts, specifically the talk groups. Now that I've added the talk groups, I can now add the RX group lists. You don't have to, but I like to have one RX group list per talk group, even if each list only contains one talk group. Next, I need to add personalities. Generally, you'll need one personality per talk group. In the personality, you'll need to give a name and set the TX contact name. I'm not using RAS here, so you can set it to none. You also need to set a site list, but I'll come back to that once I've set up both personalities. You'll notice there are no frequencies here. That gets set somewhere else, and I'll come to that shortly. TX admit criteria is set to color code free. If you're going to be using channel free, make sure to set the RSSI value to something other than the default of minus 124 dBm. Now I need to create a Capacity Plus voice list, but I can't do that because there aren't any system channels to add. The voice list contains the physical and logical channels as well as the slot IDs. To add system frequencies, I need to go to the channel pool and add them there. The voice list is then in turn referred to in the site list, and the site list is referred to in each of the personalities. When adding physical channels in this zone, only the color code TX and RX frequency needs to be specified. In the voice list for each site, make sure that the channel and slot ID matches that what is in the repeaters. So the channels in the channel pool are tied to the voice list. The voice list is tied to the site list, and the site list is tied to the personality. That's how the radio knows what frequencies to use at each site. In EMEA models, by default, there is a CB zone in the list of zones. I prefer to delete it. If you're in Australia, you may be interested in this. Back in Radio View, I need to assign the configuration I edited to the radio in question. I also need to set the radio alias and ID. Let's put the radio into a group. Now I can analyze. And again, I made a mistake with RAS. I also deleted some channels that were referenced in the scan list. To fix these, I need to go to the scan list and remove the missing reference. If you double-click on the error message, RM takes you directly to the field that's created the error. Then, to fix RAS, I just need to point to the known RAS key, even though I'm not using RAS in this case. To be sure, I run Analyze once more, and this time it comes up green. I can now write this radio. You don't have to have Device Programmer open. I have it here just to show you what's happening in the background. That's it for now. In the next video, I'll look at the routers, add the second site, and add another radio.